know that 104.9 is screaming right now with some music right now as you are here. Can you hear it? Can you hear it right now? Does it mean that you are not saying anything? It just means that you have not yet tuned in to 104.9. The reason why many of us are not hearing God is because we are not tuned into His channel. Amen.
Amen.
We are tuned into every other voice but His voice. And by God's grace, I want to tune into His voice. Because His voice is always right. How many of you know God is always right?
Amen.
That is why your Bible says that God cannot lie.
Cannot.
Not that He won't lie, He cannot. It is impossible. I like to say it this way. It is impossible for God to lie. If God came to you right now today, you know, this is a little light, you know, purple, right? If God looked at me today and said, Alfred, you are wearing red, you know He won't be lying. He won't be lying. Because the moment He said, Alfred, you are wearing red, it will become red.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. Oh, see, now I just said something. See, that is why you may be feeling some symptoms in your body, but God says you are healed.
Amen.
See, sometimes, you know, we preach faith, and people say, you are talking about all these confessions of faith. You know, if I say what I know I'm not feeling, am I not lying? No, what you are feeling is what is lying to you. The word of God is what? Truth. Truth outweighs every fact. Truth never changes. Facts will always change. Are you listening to me? So you want to be on God's side. Another thing, and then I go, you know, turn with me to Romans chapter 8 while you are turning there. Another thing, you know, we've said is this. There are always three sides to every matter. How many sides?
Three.
Not two. You know, for all of you, again, this will still lead into some pride. You know, people who are walking in pride always think that they are always right. Alright? So to some people, there is only one side to every issue. My side. How many of you have heard my way or the... Well, I will take the highway. Thank you very much. The highway of holiness. Amen. So there are not one side to an issue. There are not two sides to an issue. There's always how many?
Three
sides to an issue. My side, your side, his side. And the goal is for us to all move towards his side. Because guess what? His side is always the right side. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, somebody. And so we don't ask the question, whose side is God on? God is nobody's side. He is God, you are not. How dare you even ask that question? No. The question is, whose side are you on? Eh? Back in the day, when Moses wanted to destroy some people, the question, I mean, it's an age-old question was asked. Who is on the Lord's side? That's the question we have to be asking in our day. Who is on the Lord's side? But if you don't know the Lord's side, how can you know that that's where you are? That is why it's incumbent upon the pulpit to be able to hear where God is and be able to speak with no fear. You know, I need your prayers because we're going to go into some things. And so this morning as I woke up, started, you know, talking my father language. You know, I speak four languages. I speak English. No, in fact, is it all fine? I speak English, I speak G, I speak Fanti, I speak Ghan, so that's four. And then I speak tongues. Five. The first four is my mother tongue. The last one is my father tongue. And I like that one better than all of them. Amen. He who speaks in unknown tongues speaks to who? God talks to God. So when you hear me start going, and you say, what's he talking about? I ain't talking to you. Mind your own business. I'm talking to you. Okay. Are you okay? Am I offending you yet? Okay. Stay on for the next 30 minutes. I might get it. Amen. That's why you have to, if you don't speak in tongues, you are missing something. Amen. I didn't say you were not saved, but you are missing a lot. Amen. So anyway, as I woke up and by God's grace just went into the presence, you know, some things have been happening the last few days. I've been doing some teaching and God has been speaking, but I was determined to continue in the series. But I felt in my spirit, God began to deal with me and said, Alfred, I mean, you cannot be like ostrich. You cannot pretend as though your people or that my people are not seeing and hearing what's going on. Amen. And if by God's grace, I am the set man here. By God's grace, I am the pastor. I better have something to say to those who come here. And you better know where I stand. Amen. You better know where I stand. And then you can choose to decide where you're going to be. Whether you're going to listen to CBS, ABC, CNN, Fox News, HLN, which ones again are there? Amen. Can I tell you something? Those people get your news, but always take it with a grain of salt. Because they ain't for you. The media is controlled by the prince of the power of the air. And his agenda is always to sow discord and confusion. And where there is confusion, Bible says there is every evil work. God is not the author of confusion. It is a sad statement that even the church is sucked in. Oh, the devil is a liar. I refuse. I refuse. We've been learning on Wednesdays. If you've been missing Wednesday nights, you're missing something. We've been learning that we are not mere men. I am not a human being. I am a God being. I am a new creation. Are you listening? I am not of this world. Therefore, I am not controlled by this world system. I am of God. The meaning of that means that that is where my source is. Therefore, that's where my resource comes from. Is somebody here with me? And so I began to God say, you got to say it. And I put it out of my face, God, I hit my spirit. You better announce today is Reconciliation Sunday. Come on, tell me someone to say Reconciliation Sunday. What does that mean? It means that it's time to reconcile. Someone say, that should be every day. I know. It should be every Sunday. But at least we'll start today. It's a sad statement in America and many other places that Sunday is still the most segregated day of the week. It's a sad statement in the church. The black church, white church, African church. How many of you know what this church is? I'm glad you don't know. That's it. Amen. Because we ain't a white church, we ain't a black church, we ain't an African church, we are Jesus' church. Amen. Everybody who wants Jesus can come here. Oh, you didn't say amen. Because you want me to be an African. No. I refuse it. I didn't come from Africa to come and pastor Africans only. I am a missionary. Are you listening to me, somebody? Where in the Bible do you have white church and black? You know some blacks will never go to a white church. And you know some whites will never go to a black church. But they don't mind going to hell. Oh, I'm sorry. Are you praying for me? I'm out on Facebook Live. Oh. Amen. We are a bunch of babies in the church. We are a bunch of children in the church. And I'm about to talk to you about becoming a son. It's time for us to grow up. In the body of Christ. And I'm going to say this with all humility and gravity. There are a lot of children behind pulpits. Anyone behind a pulpit who promotes strife is a child. And they have no business behind a sacred desk. The desk, this pulpit is not to, put out grievances. This is not a place to settle scores. This is holy. You preach the word and let the word do the work. Are you here with me, somebody? This is not a self-promotion thing. This is God's house and this is God's people. And God has redeemed us with the same blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when you are looking at what is happening and you are reading all the stuff on Facebook and you see Christians bashing other Christians, you know the devil is on the loose and the devil is doing a is having a party. now the worldly people don't have to do our work for us. We're killing our own selves, right? Amen. We're talking against one another. I don't care who you voted for. You still obey the Bible. Are you listening to me? Your vote is up to you. But at the end of the day, we all follow this one. Not your interpretation of this one. What this one says. If God says pray for those in authority, you pray for those in authority. Are you listening to me? And you don't like the person in authority? Well, pray that somebody will change something. And be the first change. Thank you, Mama. I accept that I'm clout. Amen. Okay. Am I okay? Am I in the right church?
Yes.
Are you in Romans chapter 8, verse 19? I have about 30, 45 minutes, so let me see what we can do here. Someone say Reconciliation Sunday.
Reconciliation Sunday.
Hallelujah. Romans 8:19. Yes, you there? I gave you about 45 minutes already. All right. Okay, this is NIV, and then we might take Amplified also. For the creation, hallelujah. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. I'll be honest to tell you, that is not the right translation. So let's go to, give me Amplified. We're gonna break some things down and see where the Lord takes us. Amplify. Alright. For even the whole creation, all nature, do you see that? Waits expectantly and longs earnestly for God's sons to be made known. Wait for the revealing. Oh, I love this. The disclosing of their sonship. Someone say, of their sonship.
Of their sonship.
The unveiling, the disclosing, the revealing. King James says, the manifestation of the sons of God. Come on and say, the whole world is waiting for me.
Yes.
Let's start from there. Come on, say it again. The whole world is waiting on me. To
show up.
To be revealed.
To be revealed.
The Bible says, the whole earth, the whole cosmos, the whole system of government, everything is waiting for you to manifest. We are going to talk about who the you is. That is what is going on, folks. In Spain, in Sierra Leone, in Africa, it's not just happening in America, but we are in America, so we're going to deal with America. But everywhere there is upheaval. Everywhere there is a shaking. Everywhere some things are moving. And do you know why? Because the earth is under the force of sin. This is not the world God created in Genesis chapter 1. This is not the situation God created initially. There is somebody who stepped in and put, hallelujah, the cause of nature into chaos. He is called Satan. He is called Abaddon in certain places. He is called the dragon in certain places. He is called the old serpent in certain places. He is called Lucifer, the devil, and his agents. Once he landed on earth, your Bible says, war to earth. He came with the war. He came with the vengeance. And his vengeance has caused man to sin. And the whole earth has now become out of course. While we are thinking of that, I got to do this. Go with me to Psalm 86. Let me show you something. Psalm 86. I want to talk to you. Because you are the answer people are waiting on. You are the solution people are waiting on. As you are looking at what is going on in the news, my heart is burning. Hallelujah. Because people are looking at Washington as though answers can come from Washington, D.C. People are looking at man. Man doesn't have an answer for what is going on. Hallelujah. Superhuman beings need to rise up and take charge of what is going on. Obama didn't have the answer. Trump doesn't have the answer. Amen.
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 I'm just going to go ahead and say, what is happening? It's not, what is, you try to tell me what is happening is about statues? A statue? Are you kidding me? A statue is making you feel left out? Lord have mercy. Now, please, I'm also a black man, so I can say some of these things. I know white people, when they say, you know, I'm a black man. Are you understanding me? I know what slavery is about. So I'm not being insensitive. I'm not trying to be. I'm not trying to be. I love you. But folks, a statue didn't put food on your table this morning, did it? Now, don't get me wrong. I wish they can clear all the statues, including that big one in Ellis Island, the Statue of Liberty. They can, you say, oh, yeah. They can bring them all to that. Does it mean that when that one comes out, I no longer have liberty? That's the one that gave you liberty. You see what I'm going with it? Are you understand? It's time to mature. See, this one is for grown, this message is for grown up folks. Amen. On Wednesdays, we'll be talking about it's time to grow up. But I'm going to tell you, 80%, if not more, of the church is our sick children. And I'll prove it to you. I'll prove it to you. Statues. Tear down all the statues. After that, you are okay. You'll be fine. Once all the statues come, there will be no more racism, right? Is that true?
No.
Then what is the problem? And somebody has to die. Look at this. God stands in the assembly. Give me King James because Amplify will amplify it too much. And I need time. Or ESV. Again, ESV. Thank you. Are you okay so far? You still love me?
Yes.
All right, thank you. A Psalm of Asaph. God has taken his. Oh, I love this version. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Hallelujah. This is going to hit on every side, so just get ready. Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Hallelujah. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge or understanding. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. Why? I said, you are gods. Sons of the Most High God. All of you, nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince. Real quick, the Bible says God has set his place in the divine council. And then he explains who that council is. See, in some verses, says he has set his place in the midst of the gods. And so people say, are there many gods? No. You know who he's talking about? You. You were created to be a God kind. Not big G, little G. Okay, let's make that clear. See, but God wants to counsel with you. This is where sonship is coming. See, God wants to dialogue with you. See, God has authority and jurisdiction in heaven. He gave air to man. So man is the God of air. God is the God of the universe, heaven. Through our fellowship and communion with God, we were going to be able to execute our dominion the way God wanted it. But God as God is illegal on earth.
Yes.
He's illegal to operate. Again, this will explain why. People say, if God is God, why is this happening? Why? No. He's like, why are you not doing something? See, we're asking God to do something. He says, why don't you do something? I give you authority. And the only way I can come and do anything some permission. I need a partner on earth to give me permission. That is why prayer is what prayer is simply giving God permission to act on man's behalf. No prayer, God's hands are tied. Are you listening to me? Well, that's another time. God, man, willingly gave the lease of the earth to the devil. Became the subject of the devil, but thanks be to God, a man from God. A man from God came down to restore order. His name is Jesus. That's why Jesus had to be born of the Virgin Mary. He had to come into the earth legally as a man, not as God. Jesus didn't do nothing on earth as God. Everything he did as a man. That I said, because I did it, you can also do it. I am showing you how to live. That is why Jesus said, I am the Son of God. Jesus never said anywhere he was a child of God. I'll prove it. Okay. Jesus was not a child of God. He was a son of God. There's a difference. But God says, I have come and I'm sitting in the council of the divine. You and I. But then he said that you guys have begun to do things wrong. You are not doing justice. You are not thinking of the fatherless. See, he didn't say the government has to do that. That is the church. No, happening. See, when the church fails to do what it's supposed to do, then the government tries to pick it up. And how many of you know the government never does the right thing? Because they always pick winners and losers. Because they want is self-preservation. Government is all self-preservation. They want your vote, right? So they will tell you what you need to hear, right? And then you give it to them. And then 10 years later, you are still where you are. Ah, Lord have mercy. Oh, may we be delivered. God is talking to church, ecclesia, legislative body, his partners on earth. Are you listening to me? We are responsible for that. But this is where I want to go. Go with me to the first chest before this. He says, the whole earth is out of course. Why? Because the people that are supposed to keep it in order are not in place. I said you are God, sons of the Most High, all of you. You are God. Jesus repeated that in John chapter 8, by the way. Nevertheless, like men. See, you are not just a man. But if you don't act like God wants you to act, you are acting like men. And that's what is happening everywhere. People are acting like mere men. And the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 3 tells you that when you are in strife, and when you are in division, and when you are, you know, taking sides, and you are taking sex, you are acting as a mere man. And it calls you a baby. Anytime you allow strife in your heart, you are a baby. You are acting like a mere man. And say, nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince. Because the whole earth is out of course. That is why we came to that scripture in Romans chapter number 8, Romans chapter 8, where he says that the whole earth is crying out now. That's what he's talking about. Because it is out of course. Folks, what is happening is not natural. It is not, hallelujah, a physical fight. Folks, can I tell you something? Please, hear me out. What is happening is still a spiritual fight. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God. To the pulling of strongholds, mindsets that have been generational. You got to go to the root. Somebody has got to go to the root. And the root of anything that is natural is in the spirit. You don't deal with it in the spirit first, you can't get it out of your natural system. The Bible says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not walk after the flesh, because the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. The Bible says, hallelujah, you are not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness in the atmosphere, against spiritual wickedness in high places. The devil will kill you whether you're a Republican or a Democrat. Because he came to steal, kill, and destroy. Folks, let's be honest. Racism doesn't have a party. Racism is a spirit, and you're just walking about to see if you have room. There was a time in the past where it was associated with Democrats. You don't lie to me now. Now, the same spirit is now associated with the other one, the right. You see what I'm saying? It knows no. He's just looking for open door. It's a spirit. He came to steal, kill, and destroy. Are you listening to me? That's what he knows to do. So whether the other person is killed on this side or the other person is killed on that side, that spirit is just getting blood. Listen to me. The devil is after blood. Whether it is white blood, black blood, yellow blood, blood is red, and the devil loves to see blood. That's why he will engender Cain to kill his own brother Abel. It don't matter whether it was Cain killing Abel or if he couldn't have access to Abel to kill Cain. It didn't matter. All he's looking for is blood. So why do you get sucked into his agenda? We are for life, not for death. So I don't want nobody to die on any side. Oh, come on, somebody say amen. Jesus said, I have come that you may have what? Life. And have it more abundantly. I want my white brothers to have life. I want my black brothers to have life. I want my Chinese brothers to have life. I want everybody to at least have the opportunity to hear that Jesus loves them. And they give them an opportunity to say yes or no. If that's not in your heart, then let me ask you something. Are you really saved? And how can you bring the gospel to somebody you don't like? How can you bring the gospel to somebody you wish was dead? I'm telling somebody something. You see, we got to open our eyes. It's not about black and white. It's not about R or L. It is about Jesus and the devil. And you got to choose whose side you are. You got to stay in that middle, in that upper place, and say, I am a son of God. The Bible says that the earth is crying. Listen to me. Let me repeat it again. There's a groaning going on. After this, there's going to be something else. Folks, if you don't deal with it to the root, it's not going to end. Rumors of wars, we are going to keep on fighting and killing each other. Because the earth is finding something. Until the sons of God rise up and stand up, not as a man, but as a God-ordained person, and like Jesus, be able to stand and say, peace, be still.
Amen.
For the sake of time, now, I told you, so he's looking for sons to arise. Somebody say, sons to arise.
Sons to arise.
The question is, who are the sons of God?
Amen.
That's a question now. Who are the sons of God? There are two terms in your Bible, in the New Testament, that we use for sons. That is why in the previous version, in NIV, in Romans chapter 8, what we read, it said children. And that is a wrong interpretation. Sometimes they interchange. So I want to help you to understand something. That not all children are sons. I'll say that again. Not all children are sons, but all sons have to be children first.
Amen.
You cannot become a son without first being a child, but you can become a child and never get to become sonship. And let me say this, sonship is very important because only sons have access to inheritance. We've said it here before. Children don't. The Bible says in the book of Galatians that while you are a child, you are just like the servant under tutors, and you have no access to the inheritance until you mature into sonship and your inheritance can be given unto you.
Amen.
Folks, if you want an inheritance, you can say, oh, I am an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Yes, you are potential. But it doesn't mean that you will enjoy it. Children can't enjoy. Oh Lord, help me. You can't enjoy the inheritance. How many of you parents in the house will give your car keys to your 10-year-old to drive your... I see you have a nice Mercedes out there. Is that... Would you give it to my daughter to drive it? She's only 11 years old. Not that young, right? Not even your own child. Amen. Thank God, my dear daughter here has started driving. Jamie. Amen. I remember about 2-3 years ago when she was about 14, she was like, oh, I can do it. And Nini said, uh-uh. But now she's been allowed a little bit. Why didn't Janine give her car keys at 13, 14 years old? Wasn't she still the daughter? But you ain't ready yet. Some of us, we ain't ready for prime time yet. Stop joking. I don't care what suit you are wearing. I don't care what title you put there. There are bishops that need to. Amen. I don't care what title you have. You are still a baby. You are still a child. Because I can tell. Can't you tell the difference between children and sons? The way they behave, right? Every little thing, they are offended, right? Every little thing, you know, they won't find. No, children. I won't give my car keys here to my daughter. She's hoping she'll be 15 years old by, you know. But even then, maturity is what counts. So you have access to it. You have potentially to be able to get it. But you will enjoy it. Why is it that? That's the reason why. Where is the power in the church? Where is all the stuff that we read on, that we have been talking about? Where? I mean, is God dead? Come on, we had a movie out there, God is dead. But to some people, he is. Because his children are not showing up. Are you listening to me, people of God? God is not dead. The book of Acts is still, is supposed to still go on. But God will not give power to immature people. You will use it for your own thing. And it's happening. The moment you heal some headache, now you have a healing ministry. Right? You see it everywhere. The moment, you give somebody a prophetic word, now you are a prophet. You print your cards out there, I'm a prophet. Because you told somebody they were wearing color green. Are you here with me?
Yes.
It's sonship. Not all children are sons. Who are the sons? Two terms. The first term is the word technon. Go with me to John chapter 1 verse 12. Let's break some things down. I hope I'm helping somebody because we got to go somewhere. With the time we have left, we got to go somewhere. John chapter 1 verse 12. I can quote it for you. It's a popular verse. Look at this. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become what? Children of God. Some verses say sons. It shouldn't say sons. It should say children. Because the term used there in the Greek is the term technon. Someone say technon. T-E-K-N-O-N. Technon. The word technon signifies an offspring. Someone who is born into a family. You are hearing me? So you are a natural descendant, if you will. So my children, once they were born, they were technons. They were put tables. They were not yet sons. No. They were children. And your Bible says, once you believe on his name, you have... Do you realize that it didn't even tell you you become a child of God? Read the Bible. Go there again. Look at this. Does it say, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, they became children of God. Is that what he said? Come on, read the Bible. To those who receive him, who believe in his name, they become children of God. Is that what he says? He gives you the right to become. Does it mean that you have become?
No.
You have to take that right. So there are people sitting in churches who have not yet taken that right. You have the right. You have the power. But if you are not using the power, you don't become. So that's why sometimes I tell people, check whether you are truly born again. Don't lie yourself to hell. Because there are many people sitting in pews who ain't born again. They think they are. If you truly think that you hate somebody, you are not born again. Bible, 1 John. We know that we have passed from life to death Because we love the brethren. Because we are passed from death to life. That's born again, right? From the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God. From the kingdom of death to the kingdom of life. It says, we know. Someone said, we know. So I know that I am born again. I know that I have moved from death to life because I love the brethren. So no loving the brethren have I yet passed from death to life. Check your heart. Check your heart. I don't care whether your papa started that church. You can die in that church and go to him. I check without love. Without love. Without love. Now, I know that, you see, when we are born again, the love that God gives us is in a seed form. Okay? And so, yes, some of us, we are still children. It is there. You are born again. But you have not developed that love to where it is active. So, I'm not telling somebody, oh, because I hated my friend yesterday, so I'm not born. I'm not saying that. But it is good for you to check your heart. If you really allow God to work in it, he said he has shed abroad in your heart the love of God by the Holy Spirit, which he has given unto you. So if you don't have love, you don't have Jesus. I don't care how much prayer you pray. I don't care how much tithe you have given. No love, no Jesus. No Jesus, no heaven. It's okay, smile at me. Am I helping someone? Tell me. To those who believe in his name, who receive him, he gave them the right. Someone said, I have the right to become children of God. Look at verse 13. It will show you what. Who were what? Born not of blood, nor of will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So when you are born again, you are born into a new family. Oh, that should make you happy. See, I'm no longer in the family of Adam. Yeah. Some people say, oh, we are all from Adam. Well, fine, you stay there. I was from Adam, I have now been translated. I'm now in the clan of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. There is Adam and there is Jesus. Guess where I am now? Jesus. Adam is no longer my father. Amen. I got life now. Jesus, born of God. But I am a child. Born into a family, and that is where I remain. And some people remain there till they die. They never grow up from being children to the next level where they can command some power, some influence, some dominion. If you remain a child, you are just like a mere man. God can do nothing with you. God can do nothing with children. I know he can use you to preach, but I'm talking about bringing order back into your cosmos. Remember, he says that the earth is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Sons of God. So now, we have said that's the first one. The second word used for sons is the word ouios. Someone say ouios. I know. You know, Greek, that's why we don't talk Greek anymore. Sometimes I don't even know the spelling. Ouios. But that is the real word, son. And ouios means not just somebody who is born into a family, but somebody now who has developed and now become like their father. So now you don't just know them that, oh, like for example, there are a lot of people who once they see Joshua and they see me, they're like, oh, that's your son. Alright? I understand. So yes, he's born, he has my genes. But in the Jewish context, he is not yet a son. He's a child of Alfred, but he's not yet the son of Alfred. That's why in the Jewish system, they will train you in your first 12 years, give you all the information, and at 12 years, that's where they have that what they call bas mitzvah, meaning that you have now graduated into sonship. That is why at the age of 12, Jesus was talking to the people. That was his bas mitzvah right there. He was discussing with the people, the elders, and they were wondering, who are you? And when his mother came and was asking him, what have you been saying? Didn't you know I was supposed to be about what? My father's business. Was he talking about Joseph? He had just graduated into sonship. And from that time, and especially when he began his ministry, Jesus never used the word, I am a child of God. Because he was not born by God. He is God. He is God. Jesus is God. He didn't need to be born. And you know the Apostles' Creed? Jesus was not created. He was a creator. He was with God in the beginning. But to become our Savior, he had to be born into the world. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. That is why your Bible says in the book of Isaiah chapter 9, unto us a child is what?
Born.
Unto us a child is what?
Born.
But unto us a son is what?
Given.
Sons are not born. Sons are given. Or, in other words, sonship is earned. Sonship is conferred upon you. Children are born. Sons are given. Let me ask you a question. Are you just a child or are you yet a son? And I'm talking to the women too, by the way. I've told them, I've told people, if I can be called a bride of Christ, you can be called a son of God. So women say, I am a son of God. It's okay. See, it is that feminist spirit that is trying to change the Bible. What you don't understand is that in the Bible, daughters didn't have inheritance. So as a woman, be glad. See, the sonship is not gender. It is a spirit. Are you listening to me? Is somebody here with me? Hallelujah. He said, son. Jesus, everywhere he said, I am the son of God. That is what made the Jewish people, it aggravated them the most when he said he was a son. Why? Because what he was saying was, I am just like my father. That is why he could say, if you see me, you have seen the Father. Amen. Listen, everything Jesus said on earth, for the most part, he was referring to his manhood. Him saying, I'm the son of God, was not in a sense saying that, oh, I am God per se. Even though he was. Ah, Lord help me. What he was saying was, I have grown to the point that now I think just like my father. I talk just like my father. I act just like my father. I am my father.
Yes.
When you get to the place where you become a son, you are saying, if you see me, you have seen the Father. Do you know that today, you and I say this always, and this is my goal. I'm not preaching it because I think I'm arrived. Not in the least. But I am striving.
Amen.
I am striving for that. Jesus is my standard, not a man. Listen, I have come to the conclusion that anything I see Jesus do, anything I've seen him speak, I can say the same thing for myself, because he came in my place to show me how to live life. And so if Jesus could one day say, if you see me, you have seen the Father, a day is going to come, and I declare now is that you and I need to be able to stand before the world and say, who do you think you are? Oh, if you see me, you have seen the Father. If you look at me, you have seen the Father. If you hear me, you have heard the Father. Because I don't say what I want to say. I only say what I hear my Father say. And I only do what I hear my Father do. I am thinking like my Father. I am talking like my Father. I am healing like my Father. I am loving like my Father. I am doing everything I'm doing just like my Father. Why? Because now I am a son.
Yes.
Sonship. We got to get to the place of sonship. So real quick, Jesus said, I am a son of God. Not just a child. Because now I'm like my father. And so the question again is, as we begin to wrap up, is this. So who is the son of God? Now go with me to Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Let me give you some more scripture. Am I giving you a scripture?
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's more to this, but I want to learn somewhere to challenge at least those of us here. And if you may be watching me by Facebook Live, you are the solution. You are the answer. And the answer, I beg to say, please, the answer is not to throw fire with fire. The answer is not to get into argument with somebody. The answer is not just to, hallelujah, put out some statement out there. The answer is not to hit back. The answer, hallelujah, is to stand like God will stand up. And And I'll tell you what God will do in sad times like this. How many of you remember the statement WWJD? How many of you know WWJD? What will Jesus do? I think this is the moment in our society that we need to ask that question seriously. And I know some will say, oh, Jesus will be the first one pulling down statues. Really? You think really Jesus has time to go pull down statues? He'll be going to their homes, sitting down with them, talking over dinner, and expressing his heart to them. Even when they stone him, he will still be saying, Father, forgive them. Oh Lord, have mercy. Okay, number one, sons of God. This is what qualifies you to be a son of God. Alright? Are you ready? Look at this. Romans 8 verse 14. Remember John chapter 1 verse 4. What did he say? As many as received him, he gave them the power to become what? Children of God. But now, he's about to tell you who are sons of God. We know how to become a child of God. Receive Jesus. Become born again. But from there, this is what makes you a son. Look at this. For all who are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. Right? Is that okay? Everybody can become children. Receive Jesus. You are a child of God. You go to heaven. Fine. But this is what qualifies you, number one, to become a son of God. Led by the Spirit. Let me ask you a question. Do you think everybody, even in the church, is being led by the Spirit? So again, me, Bible talks to me. Based on this scripture, if you are not led by the Spirit, are you a son of God? Oh, come and talk to me. Are you a son of God? If you are not led by the Spirit, Bible says, you are not a son of God. Stop kidding yourself. I know sometimes we are in and out. Maybe today I'm led by the Spirit. Well, the moment you are led by the Spirit, you are operating in sonship. But sometimes you know we come in and out. God's goal for us is that we will stay there. Yes. Jesus stayed there. Jesus never deviated. He stayed there. That means that even when he was sleeping, he was being led by the Spirit of God. Are you here with me, somebody? Everything he did, that's why everything he did was right. Even when the people didn't like him, he was doing God's work. Yes. Are you here with me? Those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Let me ask you a question. Based on what is happening, if you are shouting at people, hating on people, are you being led by the Spirit? Will the Holy Spirit ever lead someone to hate on any other person? Will the Holy Spirit lead you into offense? Will the Holy Spirit lead you to hate, to kill someone? So again, judge, this is God's stance. So judge what you are watching and judge what you are, your response. If you are responding out of love, are you being led by the Spirit? Because all the Spirit knows is love. The Bible says we are shed in our heart the love of God. How? By the Holy Spirit. The only thing the Holy Spirit knows how to put in your heart is love. So anytime you operate out of love, you are by yourself. So nobody should tell me they are doing God's job by causing strife or anything else. Does that make sense? If you are promoting strife, if you are promoting unforgiveness, if you are promoting bitterness, you are on your own. In fact, you are being led by somebody. Because man will be led by one person or the other. You are either being led by God or... Jesus told the Pharisees, the religious people, you are of your father, the devil. And can I say this? Don't go in. Can I say this? There are many people that Jesus will step in the pulpit and say, you are of your father, the devil. Because only the devil came to lie. Only the devil came to steal. Only the devil came to kill. Only the devil came to sow strife. Only the devil came to separate people. Only the devil came to divide people. Only the devil does all that stuff. God brings people together. God brings people together. God brings them, hallelujah, the opposites together. Is somebody here with me? What I'm saying to you is this, that being a son of God and being led by a Spirit of God will cause you to begin to bring, hallelujah, people together, begin to forgive people. It takes the power of God to forgive. It takes the love of God to forgive. It takes the Holy Spirit. Folks, what is happening is not going to be solved by unbelievers. It's not going to be solved by people who are out there in the world. God is looking at the church and saying, where are my sons? Where are my children? Where are the people that I have filled with my Holy Ghost that will not take sides but will be ready to take over and say, Jesus loves you even while you hate me. Number two, sons of God. Now go with me to Matthew chapter 5. We did some of this thing on Thursday somewhere and then on Friday. Matthew chapter 5. Are you here with me somewhere? This is the answer to what is happening. Matthew chapter 5 verse 9. Matthew chapter 5 verse 9. Lord, thank you for your love. Alright, let's do this again. Number two, where you know you are a son of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Bye. Blessed. Well spoken of. God is sitting up there celebrating when you are a peacemaker. Because you are called sons of God. What does it mean based on the definition we gave? Sons of God are people who have arisen to the place where they are just like their father. Like father, like son. And so when you begin to operate as a peacemaker, who is a peacemaker? A peacemaker is somebody who is a reconciler. Somebody who brings, hallelujah, two opposite people together. Do you realize that he didn't say that blessed are the peacekeepers? There's a difference between a peacekeeper and a peacemaker. A peacekeeper only comes in after, you know, ceasefire. You know, some people, this is interesting to work in marriages. You know, in some marriages, there's only ceasefire. There's not really love going on. We've just decided to, you know, everybody stay in your corners. Yes. But the slightest thing that comes, oh. And that's what, see, America thought that we have overcome racism until something triggers it. Then you know what's really in the heart of people. It's not really peace. And so we are keeping the peace. How many of you know North Korea and South Korea, they are still at war. They've never fought. They are still at war. They call something the DMZ, the demilitarized war. So there are soldiers parked there because if they leave, oh my goodness, something's going to happen. Sometimes we begin to become peace. No, God doesn't want you to keep peace. He wants you to make peace, create peace. You are a peace creator. See, when you show up and when you are there, pastor, they will come out and fight against each other again. Because love always beats hate anytime. Love and hate are not opposites. Just like light and darkness are not opposites. Yeah, I know that's what the dictionary will tell you. But light is more powerful than darkness. All you got to do with darkness is show up with the light. All you got to do with hate is show up with love. Are you here with me, somebody? And I meet some people who are carrying love. You are so loveful that when you show up somewhere, the love overflows. It is only hate people who hate people. Put it out there. Only forgiving people know how to forgive. Are you listening to me, somebody? Save people will save people. Are you here with me, somebody? Free people is the only people who can free people. If you are bounding people, that tells me that you yourself are already bound. If you are putting people in oppression, that tells me that you yourself are already oppressed. It is only the person who is under oppression who also wants somebody else to be under oppression. But when you are free, you want to also free somebody. When you know that you are loved, you want God to love the other person. And the only people who know the love of God are the ones I'm talking to right now. I know the love of God is in you. It is time to go out there and let that love begin to be released. The light that is in you ought to begin to shine. I tell people, can I say this? I tell people, listen, if you have racism in your heart, then you have the problem. You're either, you know, because that, if they really knew me, they would love me. Are you listening to me? See, if they really knew you, they would love you. They hate you because they didn't know you. See, I'm talking like Jesus now. He said, you hate me because you don't know me. You don't know my father. If you knew my father, you would also love me. See, so have pity on them. See, I feel sorry for such a person. Yeah. They are narrow-minded. So I'm not going to play your game. I'm just going to keep on loving you. Yes. I'm going to keep on what? Because that's all I have. I don't have any breath of hate in me. I am unoffendable. It is impossible to offend me. Someone said, well, I'm going to try. Well, try. I'll slap you. And smile at you. No. Listen, offense, my God's grace. Mm-mm. See, I want to be like Stephen. I got close. I want to be like Stephen. How many of you remember Stephen?
Yes.
Man, that guy was so full of God. They were stoning him. They were beating him. They were doing everything against him. But while he was even at his last breath, the Bible says that he looked at him and lifted up his eyes to heaven and he said, oh my goodness, hallelujah, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what to do. See, that's a sign. He is talking like his master Jesus. Just like Jesus at the cross, the Romans were beating him, the Jews were despising him. Hallelujah. Meanwhile, he was dying for them. Bible says at the point before he died, he looked at them and said, Father, forgive them. Come on, somebody say, Father, forgive them. This is your response to racism, child of God. This is your response. Whether you are African American or you are white, wherever you are, wherever you are feeling the oppression, wherever you are feeling the backlash, this is God's answer. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because if they knew that I was formed in the image of God like them, they would hate on God. When somebody hates on you, they are hating on God, because you are a child of God. You are made in God's image. That is why you can't despise another man. Why? Because that person was made in the image of God. But if they don't know, if they are ignorant, then you and I have to be the sons of God that will step in the middle, that will be the peacemakers, that will even go to them. Why they even look at you funny? You say, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. And the Bible says that when he said that, he said, oh, I see heaven open. I see heaven open. And he said this, and I see the Son of God standing by the right hand of the Father. Let me ask you a question, and I got to close. And I'm not even done. But let me ask you a question. The Bible said after Jesus ascended to heaven, what did he do? When he sat down, what did he do? And he went and he sat. Jesus went where? To heaven. And he sat down at the Father's right hand. Stephen sees him not sitting. Stephen sees him standing. What do you think is going on? Jesus couldn't sit. He had to stand up and give his boy a standing ovation. Oh. When you begin to act like your father, he can sit on his throne. Jesus was like, that's my boy. That's my son right there. Because Stephen had every right to pick some stones and throw back. Stephen had every right to rush to them and beat them up. Do you know that that was a seed that God poured in? Oh, you think, a few chapters later, Paul is on the road of Damascus. No, I believe that after that episode, that just messed Paul up. I mean, it messed it. Paul was standing there when they were stoning Stephen, by the way. In fact, he was the one. Bible says he was keeping their clothes, meaning he was the one enforcing it. And he sees, and the Bible says, while he was stoned after the Holy Ghost, while he was, they were stoning him, even the Bible says, they saw him and his face became like an angel. They're like, you see, that even enforced their story, because when love meets hate, sometimes hate can't stand love. You know, have you seen somebody where they are insulting you and they are smiling and they don't know what to do and they insult you more because they want to hurt you, but you can't hurt me, and so they want to hurt you more. At the end of the day, they will be defeated. It begins to become the seed, because it begins to think, what is in that guy that even when we are stoning him, he is still praying for us? What is in that guy? You know, Paul thought he was doing God's work, but he was doing it mean. He was doing it with bitterness. He had no love in him. That is why Paul understood what love was. That is why he was even willing to die himself. After that episode, even though he was still putting people in prison, I bet that day was haunting him every time. That is why he preached, in the book of Timothy, he said it. He said, I was there when they were stoning Stephen. That thing haunted him. Folks, when you repay good for evil, your Bible says it heaps hot coals on the person. That person can't stand that fire. Folks, we need to become peacemongers. We need to begin to become peace what? Makers. Reconcilers of the word of the living God. As you get ready to stand and we pray, and I have different scriptures, what I want to tell you is this. Your Father God is a peacemaker. That is why it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. What do I mean by that? Let me ask you this question real quick. Your relationship with God, how did it start? Who was the aggrieved person in your relationship with God? Talk to me. Who was the aggrieved person? Who was offended? Who offended who? Did God offend you?
No.
We were the ones who offended God.
Yeah.
We left God. You know, I hear people say, oh, when I found Jesus, you found Jesus, right? Because Jesus was the one lost. And you found, who was lost?
I was lost.
And he came. Who was hating on who? I hated God. My sin. Bible says that while we were yet what? In sin. Bible says that we were enmities with God. And there are some people still enmities. If you are here, you are not born again, you are an enemy of God. And God is looking for you to reconcile with him. See, God came after his enemies. So if you think that somebody of a different color than you is an enemy, if you want to be like God, you are the one who is going to seek them out to reconcile with them. You don't wait. Listen, don't wait for somebody to come and ask them, forgive me before you forgive. You forgive anyone they have not asked you to forgive yet. Because forgiveness is not for them. Forgiveness is for you. Oh, Jesus, help me out here. Are you here with me, somebody? It was God. Bible says he commended his love towards us. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And the Bible says he reconciled us to himself. And he's reconciling everything. And after he saved us, you know that there's only one ministry God gave to all of us. In Romans chapter 5 verse 20. You can put it out there and get ready to start and pray. There's only one ministry. I don't care whether you're an apostle, whether you're an evangelist, a pastor, teacher, prophet, layman, deacon. God said he has given us one ministry. It is called the what? Ministry of Reconciliation. Peacemakers. Peacemakers are the people who are going to bring the earth back into normality. Back into order. It is going to take people who are ready to reconcile with somebody other than you. For my Bible still says, for God so loved the world. The world that hated him. The world that wanted to kill him. The world that didn't understand him. The world that didn't want him. Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his best. What are you willing to give to be like your Father? What are you willing to do to become like your Father? Love attracts opposites. If you are truly walking in love, you are not loving the person who naturally will love you back. That is why just allowing yourself to be called a black check. Yeah, it's easy for blacks to love blacks. You've not done anything. Are you listening to me? When we choose to go with our kind, whatever our kind is.
Yeah.
I only have one kind now. It's Jesus' kind.
It's right.
Amen. I tell people, yeah, I know I was born in Africa, but that's not where I was made.
That's right.
Amen. Mommy, right? I tell people, I was manufactured in hell.
Woo.
And then I was assembled in Ghana. And I was dispatched to the ends of the world. Son of the world. You are not American, you are not God. You are a Christ man. Come on, somebody say, I am a Christ man.
I am a Christ man.
You are now Christ. You are now in Christ. In Christ, there is no division. Love on one another. I mean, I got more, but we gotta go home. I want to encourage somebody here today. I know we, you know, depending on how many they see. Somebody, oh, you know, I know some people have what they might call a bigger platform. You might be talking to 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people. Praise God for that. But you know what? Jesus only needed 12 people. Oh, come on, be in the spirit right now. We're gonna pray for a couple of Jesus only needed how many? 12 people to turn the world upside down. All God is looking for is the one that will say, Father, if you can use anything, use me as an instrument of your peace. You have influence where you are. You may be on a job, and yes, please, if I offended anybody, forgive me. I didn't mean to. But by the grace of God, I've shared the truth as I see. I am not here to minimize in any way what many have felt in oppression, in segregation, in all that stuff. I'm not here to do that. But I'm here to plead and to say, how long? How long is that going to continue to define who you are? How long? How long are we still going to say it was this person's fault? Folks, whether you like to hear this or not, there are people somewhere who wish they were where you are. That's true. And so, even for nothing else, thank God that you are alive. Thank God that you are in America, the land of the free, the home of the brave. And we pray to take this love message to your cubicle next to you. I challenge, and today that's what the Lord put on my heart. Call this Reconciliation Sunday. Today, find somebody other than you, of another ethnicity. Don't come to Sue. Sue is mine. Amen. And intentionally, tell them I love you. Tell them I am with you. Tell them, if you can take them to lunch, take them to lunch. Let's start a movement. You understand what I'm saying? Somebody of another ideology. Listen, I have some, you know, people that we don't necessarily agree on everything politically. It doesn't matter. I'm a Christian. Are you listening to me, somebody? Let us reach across the aisle today and make love work. You can start it in your heart. I have done my portion. Now you have to take it to wherever you go. Talk to your children. My children don't know what race. No. I know, you know, they go to a predominantly white school. But I refuse to pass on anything on them to make them see anything in racial. No. They can't bring that to my house. They can't. They cannot feel. They can't come and tell me that, oh, you know, daddy, they didn't give me A because they didn't like me. Who told you that? Who told you that? If the answer is B and you gave B, they don't have a choice. They'll give you A plus. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Put yourself out there. Because you know what? With you, there is no limit. The God person doesn't have a limit. Nobody can limit you. Lift up those hands. Lift up those hands. I'm about to lose you into some guessing. I want you to lift up those hands and begin to just talk to God and begin to ask God, Father, I want to be a sign. I want to be a solution. I want to be the answer. And if you have had any oppression, you know, you have felt it, be honest with yourself and talk to the Father and say, but Father, it still hurts. Father, I still have this. And then pray and say, Father, but I want to be a son. Therefore, Lord, help me to just get over this. Get over this offense. Get over anything and everything that I may have been introduced to, it has been passed on. I have seen, I have heard. Because I want to be a solution. I want to be a peacemaker. I want to be led by the Spirit of God. I'm telling you, if you are like that, you are indestructible. You will become unstoppable. It doesn't mean that people will automatically like you. In fact, they may even seek to kill you. But listen to me, Stephen, at the point of death, was higher than any of those stoning him. Heaven will open over you. Jesus will stand and will give you a standing ovation. If that is not more important to you than anything else, then I'm sorry, I may not have given you the word as you should. But if you are looking for God's approval, this is the way to go. The love way. The peace way. Father, we thank you today. Come on, begin to just pray. Begin to just pray. Begin to just pray. Come on, pray in the Holy Ghost in the name of the Lord Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Pray for America. Pray for those. There are many who are confused. There are many who are just being led by other people. There are many who don't even know why they are out there. There are many people who are just moved by emotions, moved by bitterness, moved by being left out. Oh, but I pray the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is arising. Bible says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. This is our time to shine. This is our time to arise. This is our time to be arisen, to arise and receive. And to manifest as sons of God. I give you praise. I give you glory, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus. As we get ready to go, I want to ask, if you are here, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, you want to begin a fresh start with Him, I want to give you an opportunity to come and be transferred into this life that I'm talking about. If you are here, you know you are backsliding in your heart. You know that you are not walking like you need to be walking in the light of God's word. I want to invite you. I know our time is a little bit gone, but just give us 5 more minutes. I want you to come to me right now. Come on, don't stand on your seat. Come to me right now. Come to me right now. Come to me right now. Come on.